your message. I'll
yes.
read that. Okay.
Yeah.
Because I couldn't understand fully. We always call divine all that we are not but wish to be. Sorry. Yeah. Sorry. All that seems to us infinitely superior, not only to all that we have done, but to all that we feel we can do. All that surpasses both our conception and our present possibilities, we call divine.
So on this, what resonated with me, Chitraji,
Mother
has shared, for those of us who don't connect with the word divine,
okay,
you can use the word perfection.
Okay.
Why Mother say that? Because divine is infinite. This object is finite. I can go and reach the object. That's the object.
Correct. Okay.
With the fact that divine is infinite, you can always be on the road to divine, but you can never touch divine, right?
Yeah. Correct.
Mother shares in prayers and meditations that the closer I go to thee, the further you escape.
Correct. So, okay. Now I understood. Yes.
Yeah. So perfection is also like that, because even if an artist says that this is a beautiful drawing, there can always be more improvisations in that drawing.
Yeah.
So that's perfection. You can never reach perfection. So that is where I could.
Yeah, now I understood. Yeah, all that surpasses both our conception and our present possibilities. Okay, we call divine. Yeah. And another book I took today, an old book actually, it's by an author from US, but he wrote about search for the soul in everyday living. He compiled all the things from Mother's conversations. There are volumes, no? 7 volumes. From those volumes, he consolidated everything. He has written about that book. It is very nice. I will read that. It is amazing the number of gems we have often have on our own bookshelves just waiting to be discovered. Over the past 20 years, I have read many segments of the question and answer series, which comprise 7 volumes recorded during the period 1950 to 58 and 1 volume in 1929. So he compiled everything actually. On that, I took the topic, our difficulties hold the key to the realization of our divine potential. This we know, but anyhow, I will read. Yeah. The nature of your difficulty indicates the nature of the victory you will gain. The victory you will exemplify in yoga. Thus, if there is persistent selfishness, it points to a realization of universality as your most prominent achievement in the future. And when selfishness is there, you have also the power to reverse this very difficulty into its opposite, a victory of utter voidness. When you have something to realize, you will have in you just the characteristic which is the contradiction of that something. Face to face with the defect, the difficulty, you say, oh, I am like that, how awful it is. But you ought to see the truth of the situation. Say to yourself, my difficulty shows me clearly what I have ultimately to represent. To reach the absolute negation of it, the quality at the other pole, this is my mission. Even in ordinary life, we have sometimes the experience of contraries. He who is very timid and has no courage in front of circumstances proves capable of bearing the most. To one who has the aspiration for the divine, the difficulty which is always before him is the door by which he will attain God in his own individual manner. It is his particular path towards the divine realization. There is also the fact that if somebody has 100 difficulties, it means he will have a tremendous realization. Provided, of course, there are in him patience and endurance, and he keeps the aspiring flame of Agni burning against those defects. And remember, the grace of the divine is generally proportional to our difficulties. this is actually very encouraging, even though we know if we lead it again and again, no. Yeah.
You know, Chitra ji, one person who is joined today, Sejal, she exactly was asking about this today, that when we have our difficulties in life, you know, some people have more difficulties, some have, you know, a little minor difficulties. So I was sharing with her that it is almost like a parent who knows that, okay, my child is capable of more, you know, he's capable of having more strength, you know, getting into the deeper strength. And that is why I am faced with more difficulties, because I am also capable of getting in touch with deeper.
Correct.
I think it really benefit Sejal, who was asking this.
Yeah.
Thank you for sharing.
Thank you for sharing. Yeah. And also it is really consoling. If I have fear, okay, definitely I have courage inside.
Exactly.
That's really, at least we should strive to bring it out, no? Yeah.
Exactly. I think that is the what we call about transformation of nature.
Yeah,
the fear can be called as inconscient. And now I have the power, with the power of my looking and observation, and hence transmutation, you know, that I connect with the deeper strength within, owing to the fact that there is fear and anxiety and all that. Yeah.
I don't think in any scriptures, I mean, they talk about all the good qualities, but specifically, this is not said. I don't think so. I don't know.
I don't know which scriptures, but Chitradi, there is a saying that in commonly, not related, connected to any particular path or religion, that the more pain and the more difficulties you face on your path, the more a winner and trials that you go through, the better you will come out at the end.
Yeah.
That is there in Christianity, that is there in Hinduism, that is there in, I think, Buddhism also.
Yeah, but
and
I...
they very specifically say ki jitna zyada dukh hoga, jitni zyada takleef hogi, that means God is, they translate it to tell, explain to us and make us feel good, and God is closer to you. So you are suffering a little more, but be rest assured, you will win. You know, I think it's there.
I talked about that quality, no? Change of quality. Because that selfishness, the selfishness has a wideness, that opposite. That thing, I don't know. Maybe. But I feel it's very special in mother's path. Selfishness will change into wideness, and fear will change into courage. If you strive patiently, that is the... underlying thing, no? Yeah. Difficulties, definitely, as you said, Jyotsnaji, correct. Yeah.
So anyone, many people have joined new today. Those of us who would like to share anything, so what we do here is we read words by masters or mystics. At the moment we are reading Sri Aurobindo and Mother. So if you feel resonating to comment, to reflect, to question, feel free at any point of time to unmute yourself and share your reflection, or maybe, you know, maybe something resonates with your life experience. Feel free to share. And those of us who are reading at the moment Sri Aurobindo and Mother, they can share what they are reading, and collectively we can reflect upon. Yeah. So if there is anyone else also who wants to share, Taru, if you have read anything, Jyotsna ji, Shreya, anybody who wants to share anything, please unmute and share.
Malika ji, Jishnu here. Very glad to listen with what Chitra ji shared. Very glad. And because you know that I had contacted you very recently, to know the function of the subconscious side, the darker side. And modern psychologists as well as yogis, they say that there is huge creativity in that part. And what does it mean? It means the transformation. And as somebody was speaking that in other scriptures, I can only tell about stories. In Buddhism, we always find the stories of Jataka and the life of Buddha, where he has transformed people. Same about Vaishnav. If we hear about Chaitanya Dev, we read stories about Chaitanya Dev. So may not be, only thing is, may not be in such a scientific manner how Mother Sri Aurobindo has spoken. But in all the philosophies or all the scriptures, we have always seen this aspect of transformation. Even the ancient thing of alchemy, where we said that the baser metals are transformed into gold, is also symbolic. And without this transformation, there is no hope for this world. Only thing is, Mother Sri Aurobindo spoke very clearly. We always know that Mother Sri Aurobindo spoke about facing the world and transforming them. And which Sri Aurobindo said that only in one part of Tantra this was done. Otherwise, it was considered as so difficult that nobody attempted. I also want to read something. This is a compilation from mostly from Mother's writings. And this heading was not given by Mother, but this heading has been given by the psychologist. The need to hunt in our little dirty corners. That is the heading. And there she has put something which Mother has written. There are people who see clearly, who know so well what they ought to do, and who do feel that they can't. They don't know why. It is nothing else but that. There is a little spot which doesn't want to change, and this little spot awaits its hour. And the day it is allowed through laxity, fatigue, somnolence, through a little inertia, allowed to show itself, it will show itself with all concentrated, accumulated energy and will make you do. Will make you say, make you feel, make you act exactly contrary to what you had decided to do. And you will stand there. Ah, how discouraging this is. Then some people will say, fate, they think it is their fate. It is not fate, it is themselves. It is that they don't have not used that light, the searchlight. They have not turned the searchlight into the small hidden corners of their being. They have not discovered what was well hidden. They have left it there. And they have done this. Mother turns away her head so as not to see how many times one suddenly feels one is on the point of catching something. It hurts a little. It is troublesome. So one thinks of something else and that's all. That opportunity is gone. What one must wait for another occasion, again to commit a few stupidities before being able to find an opportunity to catch the thing by tail, like this, or by the ear, or the nose, and hold it firmly and say, no, you won't hide any longer now. I see you as you are, and you must either get out or change. One must have a strong grip and an unshakable resolution.
That's really beautiful, Jishnuji, what you shared, you know. I think it's almost, I can relate it with, you know, in acupressure, for example, if I have a headache, the points which are hurting the most are the points which are the resolution for the headache, you know. So that's the sign of catching the right point. That which hurts the most is the point which I keep on pressing, and when it stops hurting, that is the resolution for, you know, the headache. And I think what you shared was so beautiful, that there are so many times where we observe that something, you know, something is there, I'm not able to catch it, some obscurity, some darkness is there, and if you stay with it, if you don't escape it, don't distract yourself by watching some entertainment, and, you know, or bypassing it, I think that's really another new door opens in the being. So that's so beautiful what you shared. It would be nice if you can maybe later on share the exact, you know, where is it from, or maybe share with me later. I can put it on the group, Friday study group.
I will, okay, so I will tell you the reference right away.
Yeah, please do.
Because my schedule gets crazy at times.
So I will type it in the chat.
So I will tell you, it's 21st July 1954.
Fine.
Collected works, volume 6, page 243.
Okay.
Okay, so.
Beautiful it is. Beautiful, no? Yeah, very nice.
Thank you.
Beautiful. I think it's so, as if mother's microscope, you know, it almost the biggest microscope, you know, each moment of life has been captured, you know, in several sayings and writings. It's beautiful. So I have just typed in the chat window what Dishnuji was sharing for those of us who want to read it again. 21st July 1954, Collected Works of Mother. Yeah. So would anyone else who has been reading would like to share whatever resonated or any reflection, anything?
If nobody else, then I can share something reading. And this is in the line that we always say that we see in others, let's say that we see in others the defects which are there on ourselves. And here this is, the heading is, once again here, the heading is projecting one's shadow on others. But there are actually two ways of deceiving oneself, which are very different. For example, you may be very well be shocked by certain things, not for personal reasons, but precisely in your goodwill and eagerness to serve the divine. When you see people behaving badly, being selfish, unfaithful, and treacherous, there is a stage where you have overcome these things and no longer allow them to manifest in yourself. But to the extent that you are linked to ordinary consciousness, the ordinary point of view, the ordinary life, the ordinary way of thinking, they are still possible. They exist latently because they are the reverse of the qualities that you are striving to attain. And this opposition still exists until you rise above it and no longer have either the quality or the defect. So long as you have virtue, the opposite is always latent in you. It is only when you are above both the virtue and the defect that it disappears. So this kind of indignation that you feel comes from the fact that you are not altogether above it. You are at the stage where you are thoroughly disapprove and could not do it yourself. Up to that point, there is nothing to say unless you give a violent outer expression to your indignation. If anger intervenes, it is because there is a complete contradiction between the feeling you want to have and how you react to others. Because anger is a deformation of the vital power, an obscure and wholly ungenerated vital, a vital that is still subject to all ordinary actions and reactions. When this vital power is used by an ignorant and egoistic individual will, and this will meets with the opposition from the other individual wills around, this power, under the pressure of opposition, changes into anger and tries to obtain by violence what cannot be achieved solely by the pressure of the force itself. Besides, anger, like every other kind of violence, is always a sign of weakness, impotence, and incapacity. And here, self-deception comes solely from the approval given to it or the flattering epithet attached to it, because anger can only be something blind, ignorant, and asuric, that is to say, contrary to the light. But this is still the best case. There is another case. There are people who, without knowing it or because they want to ignore it, always follow their personal interests, their preferences, their attachments, their conceptions, people who are not wholly consecrated to the divine and who make use of the moral and yogic ideas to conceal their personal impulses. But these people are deceiving themselves doubly. Not only do they deceive themselves in their external activities, in their relationship with others, but they also deceive themselves in their own personal movement. Instead of serving the divine, they serve their own egoism. And this happens constantly, constantly. They serve in their own personality, their own egoism, while pretending to serve God. Then it is no longer even self-deception, it is hypocrisy. The mental habit of always endowing everything with a very favorable appearance, of giving a favorable explanation to all movements, sometimes it is rather subtle, but sometimes it is so crude that nobody is deceived except oneself. It is a habit of excusing oneself, the habit of giving a favorable mental excuse, a favorable mental explanation to everything one does, to everything one says, to everything one feels. For example, those who have no self-control and slap someone's face in great indignation would call that an almost divine wrath. It is amazing, amazing this power of self-deception, the mind's skill in finding an admirable justification for any ignorance, any stupidity whatsoever. This is not an experience that comes only now and then. It is something which you can observe from minute to minute. And you usually see it much more easily in others. But if you look at yourself closely, you catch yourself 1,000 times a day, looking at yourself just a little indulgently. Oh, but it is not the same thing. Besides, it is never the same for you as it is for your neighbor. Just on a lighter note, on separate, Mother was speaking, she is saying here, Sri Aurobindo had written, and she is saying, I am translating freely, that the notion of sin has been introduced to hasten progress. And immediately Mother laughs, man saw sin in all others, and he never saw it in himself.
Yeah, beautiful. Chitraji, you're muted if you want to share. Yeah.
Initially, he read something. No, you have to go above both virtue and the wrong thing. You have to go above that. No? Above, yeah.
I think there was just too much. The paragraph was a little bigger. So there was a bit too much. I think we have to.
That's right.
Okay. Yeah.
I think in the first paragraph itself it came. You have to go about both the virtue and the,
So in this paragraph she is saying that, but if we study it scientifically, it is the tama, raja and satta, and then you go beyond all the gunas. So naturally one cannot directly go there. It's like steps. One has to take the steps and go there.
Correct.
Because people have sattvic ego also. I am good. I will be good. That is also sattvic ego. And that is also a bondage. For people who want to be free or people who want to follow the divine will, even Sri Aurobindo himself said that before he went to that jail, second time, he said that I had received indication that I should stop the work. He didn't use the word sattvic ego, but he felt that if I stop this work, how will the work continue? And then the circumstances were made in a way that he had to go to jail and the work got stopped, or that work got stopped. And then I saw that there are younger people coming in who are better equipped to continue this. This work will not stop because of me. I mean, if we hear his words, even the conversations, he has been so candid. Even one place he is saying, I did politics because my vital was getting satisfaction out of it. He is being so candid and honest. You know, he is not saying, no, I wanted to serve country. He said, yes, I wanted to serve country. But I also was in politics, my vital was getting satisfaction.
So anyone else, anything that you want to share, anybody?
Can you hear me?
Yes, Shreya, yes. Please go ahead. Yeah.
I was not sure if I'm audible. I wanted to ask a question based on this passage. From what I understood, I mean, there were a few lines that sort of stuck to me, and like seeing the sin in the other but not in oneself, and justifying one's own actions, even if they are not from a kind or a right place. So I wanted to know then, how do we align this with dharma and adharma? For example, how Krishna says, you know, you may be doing the wrong thing, but if it is for the better. Like that is how a lot of people justify doing things. Like I have had a personal experience of a spiritual guru being very harsh with his disciples and then justifying that, you know, I'm trying to wake you up, so you should be actually thankful to me. So at that point I thought, yeah, maybe, I mean, in the bigger picture, he is actually waking those people up perhaps from their, in a way, the vital, because those disciples were very deeply engrossed in the vital. So this line, where do I draw the line now between what would be right and what would be not?
I think
right?
my only thing here will be, your answer lies in what goal you have. You spoke about a spiritual guru who was harsh to his students, disciples. There will be so many coaches you will hear in your course. I mean, if you study sports or something else, I'm sure you will come across. There are so many physical fitness coaches who are very harsh to his students. Andre Agassi's coach was very harsh to him. And why? Because if you ask him, we don't know the name of the coach of Andre Agassi. I mean, we don't remember him. He's not a star. Andre Agassi is a star. Same with that. So the question is, what is your goal? That determines whether it is right or wrong. Probably from the point of view as a teacher, maybe it is right. Probably. Now the thing is he doing that just as a weakness of his character, or he is wearing that mask purposefully to do that? There are coaches, you know, there are physical coaches or stories I have read, but the coach knows I am being knowingly harsh to this person because I want to wake that person up. He's doing that, and he is crying when he is alone in his room. You know, he says that I am being harsh to that person because I know I have to do this, otherwise she will not be able to perform. And then that person, when alone, this coach or teacher or guru, whichever way you want to say, when alone in his room, he's repenting, he's crying. He said, no, I am willingly doing this. If I don't do this, that person has so much bondage around him, he will not be able to free himself and practice. So that is what. If that person is sincere, then there is nothing wrong. And if maybe sometime later also we can read that there is a difference between insincerity and mistake. Mistake is something which we don't know what we are doing. And insincerity is something which we know wrong, yet we are doing. Here the coach knows that he is being harsh, but being harsh is not wrong. And I will tell, I wanted to write to Monica Ji, it did not happen, but what happened is I am staying here. And I'm sharing this example. So I saw that there were some pigeons, you know, that pigeons, they have laid eggs. Now the chicks have come. And this chick wanted to fly. And the chick actually did not want to fly. I saw that this mother is pushing the chick from the balcony. You know, the mother is running after her, pushing the chick. So if you see a very limited, restricted view, what will you see? The mother is just pushing the chick away, pushing in the void. But if you see the larger picture, what do you see? She is strengthening her child for future life. And when I saw that, it was like a revelation. I thought, okay, so the life also prepares us like this. When we are going through difficulties, it is of course difficulties, but we are getting prepared for something larger and bigger. So my answer would be here, that whether you are being sincere to what you are doing, whether you feel that this is right, that should be the question, you know. Like some, I mean, during the revolutionary times, pre-independence times, there were people who would preach poverty, you know, preach asceticism, but themselves they would travel in first class. So is that right? Not right. That is what. But there were some leaders who would also travel in third class. But there are some leaders who would travel in third class for just for publicity. So what will you say?
For this harshness, Shirdi Sai Baba is very famous for this harshness. He would say the opposite, actually. Whatever sickness you get, if you go and tell him, he would say the opposite to do that. That person will get cured. We don't know about it. From outside, it will be very strange. As Shreya told, no, from outside, it will be very strange for us. But actually, the disciples know, very well know, he is doing for their welfare, actually. So we can't say that, yeah. Correct. Her question is correct, but inner circle disciples know about the Guru.
So one more thing, Shreya, which is coming to me at this is, so imagine that I am somebody who is treating the other person harshly, okay? Now, it is another matter from which space I am coming. I may be coming from a sense of love that I want to do you good. And that is why I am using the harshness knowingly. Or I may be very insincere and I am just satisfying my ego in treating you harshly. Now forget me. Okay. Now you are the receiver of harshness. It also depends greatly on your attitude. No matter whether I was doing it sincerely or insincerely. If you are able to use it for your own growth, that harshness, then the matter is completely in your favor. Completely. So people who are our critics, either they are doing it out of their love or they are doing it in their own ignorance. It does not matter to me. What matters to me is what attitude I have. How can I use that harshness to progress in life? Because you know, many a times it happens that the person did not say it in nice intention, but I took it so nicely for my own progress. So that is, I think, something also very visible here. Yeah.
Monica, I resonate with you. In school, when I was once beaten on my knuckles till the ruler broke, and I went home to complain to my father and tell him that this person, this teacher should be complained about. And my father made me sit down on the floor and he told me, if she did it to wake you, she did it for you, whether it was in good faith or whether it was out of anger. It is how you receive it. You take it with humility as a correction for yourself. And all throughout my life, however harshly I have been corrected, I think that one lesson works and it comes back and says, no, maybe the intention was to wake me up. So it's okay. The knuckles are fine. I'll improve. And I was a sportswoman till the end of my school days. I never missed a medal because of beating. One beating, I never missed a medal. So it does work. I think it's how you take it.
That's beautiful.
Yeah.
Yes. Thank you. All the insights.
I think when we are able to take things, anything so-called worse happenings for the right, with the right attitude, I think we almost... it almost connects us with this invincibility, you know, the divine strength within, that no matter how unfavorable situations may turn up, because owing to the fact that I am going to take everything for my own progress, you know, nothing can hamper your growth. So that's really You know, mother says at one point that that connects you with a deeper strength within, with the divine strength. Yeah. So forgetting about
I
the...
And that if you take it in with humility, you know, acceptance and humility, whatever be the method, I think you'll...
When humility comes, this is my doubt, I mean, always it will arise in me. Humility means humility towards divine only, no? Actually, we can't be, doormat for everyone, as if, I mean, in the name of humility.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful. Yes. Yeah. Totally, yeah. I think when one can even pick up a sword when it is necessary in humility. So, you know, if you are really taking up a sword for truth, that is also humility. Humility is not just being a passive, you know, a person and not taking up a stand at all and being a doormat completely, completely. Yeah.
See, humility is not timidity.
Correct, yeah. Yeah.
Chitradi, I would say that humility where the ego is just not there, you know, you keep your ego aside.
Yeah.
And yet not be timid and take the sword and do it, but yet you're humble and you accept to the fact as to what you are doing is justified and correct.
Correct, yeah. Because sometimes when we feel humble, no, before a person, that person is not right, and we want to be humble, and that time I will feel very weak actually. I don't know. That difference I couldn't find sometimes. That's why I told that you can't be a doormat.
So weak in the sense of Chitraji that you want to take your stand, you want to speak up, but you are not able to in that sense.
Not able to means sometimes I don't want to. I don't want to. I mean, that harmony will get spoiled. No.
Okay.
For that sense, I used to think a lot first actually. And then if I think like that, no, I'll become very weak then. If I don't come to my stand.
Yeah.
Then later I learned the lesson, of course. That's why I asked you. Humility towards divine is very, it is a very nice thing, very wonderful thing. It is really divine only is teaching us to take a stand also. I always argue like that. I can't be humble to each and every person. As she said, Jyotsna, she said, no ego. Yeah, ego should not be there. Yes, I agree. For us, it is personally. But that also, we need not show it to other person. No, there is no ego to me. You can do anything.
Yeah, I think completely, you know, that it is not to say yes to any kind of abuse in humility. Yeah, totally. Mm-hmm. One has to be very, people talk about discernment, you know. So the discernment has to be there. And you are right when you are, I think I resonate with that clearly, that humble in front of whom? Because many a times there are people whom we are interacting with. Who actually, in the way they are dealing with the world or you, they don't deserve even a trace of respect. So then, if you are humble and you are allowing all kind of abuse, I think that even the divine would not agree to that, you know.
Yeah.
That person is there in front of me only so that I can take a stand for myself and speak up and express myself. Yeah. So anything else coming from anyone? Any reading, any reflection, any doubts to share collectively? So in absence of anything, I'll just share a little bit. So this is a reference to the value of physical body. So Mother is saying that this harmonization and organization of the being around the divine center can only be done in a physical body on earth. You know, we often talk about the difference between knowing and living. So a part of me knows what is right kind of a life, but a part of me is very stubborn and not wants to live that life. So this is the harmony from the inner being to the outer surface consciousness. This has to be harmonized around a divine center, you know, the right understanding that we all have. That is truly the essential and original reason for physical life. You know, and many masters have said, Manush Janam Amol Re, human birth is precious, don't waste it, don't waste it. And yet we have our own ideas and we do waste many, many lives. But yes, here we are. For as soon as you are no longer in a physical body, you can no longer do it at all. And I think at other places I have read that in other realms, it is not possible to undergo such kind of an exponential progress as is available to a human being. So there are also more struggles and difficulties, but there is also a very big opportunity to exponentially grow in your progress, right? And then Mother says, still more remarkable is that only human beings can do it, for only human beings have at their center the divine presence in the psychic being. You know, animals, plants, the other vegetal kingdom cannot do it. You know, the psychic presence is not there. Consciousness is there, different levels of consciousness, gradations of consciousness. But this alive and conscious, self-aware psychic being is not present there. And yet, human beings come into a physical body without knowing why. Most of them go through life without knowing why. They leave their body without knowing why. And they have to begin the same thing all over again, indefinitely, until one day someone comes along and tells them, be careful. You know, there is a purpose to all this. So I found this so, so beautiful. You know, this refers to also Kabirji's couplets, because Kabirji in many, many couplets has said, why are you wasting this life? Why are you wasting this life? Eating, sleeping, drinking, why are you wasting this life? So in one of the bhajans, he also says, Chalat, chalat, jug bhayo ji, kaun batavega dham ji? So he says, you have been running and walking for years and eons. Who will tell you your destination? You know, and that is the life that we live, you know, and we are lucky if in this lifetime, at least we begin to just touch upon this, that yes, this life is there for a purpose. You know, I will invite more reflections on this. you know, these difficulties that we encounter in this, you know, that, oh my God, I have been on this path for 20 years, 30 years. I still have anger in me and I still have grudges in me. You know, this is the task. So how can it be done so easily? This is the very task, that I know that I must not be there and yet I am still there. So this harmonization against my understanding, keeping my understanding as the central truth, that yes, I know this is not beneficial for me. This is not leading me anywhere. So this harmonization of the other, you know, in almost in, what do you say? I'm forgetting the word. Almost incorrigible, you know, things that are there in me. This harmonization, getting more and more light in those obscurities, getting more and more light of understanding in mind, in emotional, in physical. This is my very task. So how can I demand that I should be rid of that? It's a false demand. If I know that this is my task as a human being, then it is most welcome. You know, I would be happily looking at all the obscurities that come on my way. So this is the big adventure Mother talks about, that all the souls plunged into this adventure readily, that yes, yes, you know, we will do it, we will do it. Yeah.
So it's a very, very important topic which you said about that harmonization of the character. And I remember somewhere Mother was telling Satprem that he was asking why this is not done, and she was saying because people are insincere. They are not following it up with sincerity, and that is why. So in the same thread, there was again another question. Here she was less severe, I would say. So here somebody was asking Mother, why do not people practice? Perhaps because people are lazy. Surely it is one of the chief reasons. And then they cover their laziness with good excuses, of which the first one is to say, I cannot, I do not know, or I have tried and did not succeed, or again, I do not know by which end to begin. It does not matter what reason, the very first one that comes up. Well, people do not practice because the girls do not find it worthwhile to take the trouble. That is also a part of laziness. It needs too much effort, but you cannot live without effort. If you rejected all effort, you would not stand on your legs, nor walk, nor even eat. I believe that people do not practice first because it has not got a reality concrete enough to dominate all other things of life, because the effort appears disproportionate to the result. But this is, all this kind of effort, it is only a beginning. Once you are inside, it is no longer the same thing. So here, I think the most important sentence here, which Mother is saying, is that the reality is not concrete enough to dominate all things in life, all things of life. Even somewhere, if we read, Sri Aurobindo is saying that the resolution was just a mental resolution, and it did not translated in the vital, physical, and other beings, which we always see, like New Year resolutions and other good resolutions that we take. Why do we take? Because a part of us want to be good. A part of us is aspiring for this adventure, which Monika ji said and Mother has spoken about, because it understands the value. But the thing is, we have different parts in us, and the other parts are not considering it valuable. The physical, the vital, they are not considering this path of discipline, the path of not penance, but probably the difficulty, which will ultimately give us good things. They are not considering it as valuable, and hence they are not following it. So the only path or method would be to make the experience more and more concrete. Once a person has that experience, and Sri Aurobindo is saying, observe yourself, observe which makes you peaceful, what makes you truly happy. And once you get that thread, follow that thread more. If you start doing that, slowly the higher parts in us will overcome and dominate the entire nature.
Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful.
And also in Savitri also he brought out very clearly Shrivinda, which lot of compassion. Book 2, Canto 2, Kingdom of Subtle Matter. Yesterday I was reading that, really brought tears in my eyes. How he is compassionate towards human beings. He is telling, I will read those lines actually. Even in this prison house of outer form, a brilliant passage for the infallible flame is driven through gross walls of nerve and brain. A splendor presses or a power breakthrough. Earth's great dull barrier is removed awhile. The inconscient seal is lifted from our eyes and we grow vessels of creative might. And also some other lines are there which he denoted how it is very difficult for the human beings actually. I will read that also. A being woke and lived in the meaningless void. A worldwide nescience strove towards life and thought. A consciousness plucked out from mindless sleep. All here is driven by an insentient will. Thus fallen, inconscient, frustrate, dense, inert. Sunk into inanimate and torpid drowse. Earth lay a drudge of sleep. Forced to create by a subconscious yawning memory. So this he totally talked about the earth actually. In this canto, no, Kingdom of Subtle Matter, first he brought out that world, subtle matter world. It is actually very beautiful but stagnant. There is no progress, it seems actually. Beautiful forms are there. From there we will get some hint, it seems, I mean, to earth beings. But the progress is only in earth, as you read, no? So, I remember these lines. Yesterday, I read this and also I watched the talk of Alokda for this canto. He beautifully explained how Sri Aurobindo is very compassionate to human beings, really. He is not telling it is easy. He is telling with our mind and with our body, it is very difficult to feel that spirit and make the spirit the nature of our, I mean, king of our nature. But we have to do, yeah.
Beautiful. Yeah. I have shared what Chitraji has shared. I have shared in the chat window for those of us who want to go through it. The lines from Savitri.
The whole canto is very nice, actually.
Beautiful.
Everything is wonderful, but here I felt how compassionate he is towards human beings.
Yeah. That was really, it's very comforting to hear. Why? Yeah. Because we see that we fail so many times on this path and we find, you know, oh my God, it's so difficult, you know, we're not finding a way through.
For that also, he writes very nicely. Those lines also there actually.
Yeah.
He said the grace of the defeat. Defeat is not, I mean, it is a grace, it seems.
Can you read those lines?
Yeah, I will bring, yeah. Mm-hmm. Bring those lines in between. If anyone is sharing, let them share. Yeah.
I'll read just a couple of lines which struck me yesterday. When mother used to take, classes in the playground and she used to read Dhammapada on Buddhism, she gave a very, somebody just provoked her in some ordinary question and she gave an answer to them. There were a lot of children also there. So she wanted to explain why she says particular things. And she says, when I give you a thought, it is simply to help you to concentrate. And this I am going to do with a very precise, a very definite purpose to bring you out of your mental somnolence and compel you to reflect and try to understand what I tell you. I mean, you know, each thing is actually to kindle us. How much we take it as a kindle, it's up to us.
Yes, beautiful. Thank you for sharing, Jyotsnavi. Yeah.
Actually, wait a minute. There is no current here, no electricity. No,
that's okay. That's okay.
Yeah.
We have.
It will come now. Yeah. They will put the generator. It will come. You want?
Yeah. If you remember a few lines, I can find it out from here and paste it.
Yeah. 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 I will do.
Chitraji, please unmute your. I just muted you owing to the noise. Yeah.
Yeah. Here was not futile efforts, broken heart, exempt from the ordeal and the test, empty of opposition and of pain. It was a world that could not fear nor grieve. It had no grace of error or defeat. He is mentioning about that kingdom of subtle matter. But earth has that defeat and error is there, no? That's why he said, even that error and defeat also grace, it seems. It had no grace of error or defeat. It had no room for fault, no power to fall. For this, I read the explanation in another book, Achula. I will read that also. Sri Aurobindo is pointing out that the possibility which our world offers of making mistakes, being defeated, being imperfect and failing is a grace because such experiences help us to grow in many ways. But that grace does not exist in that world, that subtle world. Yeah.
That's so beautiful, so beautiful. Yeah. Because, you know, as adults, the big wrong that happens with us, I believe, you know, I talk about it so many times. That we are so afraid of making mistakes, you know, and in that we stop to grow, we just rot almost, you know. And luckily are those of us who are still allowing themselves to be imperfect, to make mistakes. So that's beautiful. I can resonate with that so much, you know, so much.
Yeah, that's why really yesterday I was I was in tears really when I read these lines.
And where was this description taken from? The description that you shared
here, description is from that Savitri Bhavan invocation. No, I have that book.
By whom?
Shraddhavan.
Shraddhavan. Okay.
Yeah, yeah, yeah,
yeah.
Yeah.
Great. Thank you so much, Chitraji, for sharing this. Yeah. So I actually have to rush at 8 o'clock. There are
It's already 8. Yes.
Yeah. So thank you so much, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. For, especially for you, because you are in a busy thing actually.
No. Right. It's a pleasure and delight. Thank you, Jyotsna. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you.